Today we will be studying spray drying plant. So here we are having control panel of spray drying plant along with evaporator. And this side here we are having a spray dryer along with a two effect evaporator. So I will be explaining you first from the control panel what is the process, how milk flows from where to where. Means what is the steps involved. So starting from the evaporator, then coming finally to the dryer. So I would be explaining it you in this control panel. So there is a flow diagram already printed here. And then I will be showing actually where are these components located, how they do look like, what are their relative sizes and different parameters. Okay. So starting with this evaporator, so this side, this is the evaporator section and here this is the dryer section or drying section. So in the evaporator section, we would be starting with the feed pump, feed hopper, this tank. So this is the feed tank of evaporator and this side here we are having feed of dryer. So we are having two different tanks. This tank is feed tank of evaporator and this tank is feed tank of dryer. So feed tank of dryer will be outlet of evaporator because these are connected in series one after another. So milk will be starting feeding in the feed tank of evaporator. Then after going through this whole process of evaporation, it will come to the feed tank of dryer. And then after that, the drying part will take on. So in this feed tank, you can see we are having water inlet as well as feed inlet. Both are shown into this feed tank. Why we are having these two different feed inlets shown here is that we will be starting any dairy equipment first with water. And also water inlet is again provided for CIP purposes. So in between if we require water flushing or we require some cleaning step to occur, then we will be using this water inlet side of this feed tank for that process. Okay. After the water work of water is finished, milk inlet or feed inlet will be started for the evaporator. So let us first focus on to what are the different pipelines to be followed. So here we are seeing that after this feed tank there is a pump. So this is a centrifugal pump shown to you here and this indicator light has been shown. So when this will be operating, this light will turn on after operation of this respective switches. So feed will be coming into this feed pump, then it goes into this preheater. So as I have shown you in the previous practicals regarding three-stage evaporator, same here we are having different preheaters associated with this type of evaporator also. This is a double effect evaporator and this double effect evaporator also has a TVR. So previously we studied triple effect evaporator with TVR, this is double effect evaporator with TVR. So this is preheater 1, so feed will be going from bottom to top, then it enters in the second preheater here from top emerges at bottom. So this is preheater 2, this is preheater 1. Preheater 1 is connected with condenser. So this is a surface condenser. This is a shell and tube type of condenser, indirect cooling type of condenser. Previously we studied barometric leg type of condenser, direct mixing type of condenser. So this is having a different process. So along with the surface condenser, we are having a preheater. Then this is preheater 1, then this is preheater 2, connected to the calandria 2. This is calandria 2. In parallel, we are having preheater 2, this is small pipeline, small diameter pipeline you can see here. So this is preheater 2. After this preheater 2, milk emerges at the bottom, enters in the preheater 3 from the bottom, exits at the top. So this is preheater 3 connected in parallel with evaporator 1 or calandria 1. So this is Calendria 1, Calendria 2, and this is condenser. So we are having only two Calendrias, as it is a double effect evaporator, only two Calendrias are there. After this, we would be having a final heater, main heater or final heater, to raise the temperature of milk to the boiling point existing in Calendria 1. So that as soon as milk enters Calendria 1, it is at its boiling point and evaporation can start right away. So Calendria 1 need not to heat the milk for evaporation purpose. It is already at its boiling point, so it can start evaporating right when it enters the Calendria. So for that purpose we are having final heater. So in this final heater you are seeing that in the final heater part it is directly heated with this steam. So we are having this steam inlet shown to you here in this final heater part, and also one more steam pipeline connection can be seen here going to the TBR. This side here, this is TBR. So in between this and this pipeline, the central pipeline here, this is a thermo vapor recompressor, or TVR in short. As we know, this is TVR. So we are having only two steam connection going to the evaporation side of this equipment. Okay, so from this final heater you can see that after this final heater we are having this series of tubes here along with three-way valves connected both at top and bottom. So both side we are having a array of three-way valves at bottom side as well as on top side. We are having an array, and these pipeline, what these pipeline have to do is, the role of these pipelines is to control WPNI. You have studied whey protein nitrogen index. So high heat, medium heat or low heat powder, when we are required to produce, then we are required to maintain certain temperatures for certain time in the these tubes, so that we can have a proper degree of denaturation of whey proteins. Okay, so that we can control the WPNI index of the powder. So for controlling WPNI of powder, it starts before Calendria 1. Okay, it cannot be controlled after evaporation has gone through. So how would be controlling is, we can control by switching these valves, that from which pipeline to which pipeline the milk will be going before entering Calendria 1. Okay, so if we are selecting more number of pipelines, then we would be heating or we would be maintaining temperature of milk at higher temperature for a longer time, so as to have a higher degree of denaturation of whey proteins. And if we are selecting lesser number of pipelines in this case, then we would be having a lesser degree of denaturation, as the milk has to be stored for a smaller amount of time at higher temperature. Okay, the role of these tubes is clear to you. So this is for controlling WPNI, okay, whey protein nitrogen index. So after this, here you can see the milk from top of these tubes will enter Calendria 1 at this side. So on Calendria 1, it can be seen that there are two streams going into the Calendria. So we are having multiple circulation in single Calendria, so that same evaporator can serve as multiple effect in a smaller amount of volume. So what this means is, the feed which is going at this side will come in half of the tubes at bottom at this side, and then it can be recirculated back into the same Calendria on other half tubes. Suppose we are having say 100 tubes inside, so first 50 tubes or half of those tubes in a semicircular kind of arrangement would be in the first pass, then next 50% or 50 number of tubes will be in the second pass. So we are having two pass on tube side in this Calendria. So this one Calendria, through this one Calendria milk will be passing twice. Okay, so what advantage does it have? it have an advantage of saving of floor space, saving of equipment cost. We are utilizing only one equipment and making use of it twice, as well as it also ensure a proper wetting of tubes, curved surface area from inside. So if we are letting the feed go only once, then due to spreading of the milk film, we can have chances that in some spots the milk is not properly wetting tubes from inside and the tubes are dry, so that we can have scald particles as well as less utilization of heat transfer area as available in the evaporator. Okay, so if we increase the volumetric flow rate through the number of tubes available to us, then we can ensure that each and every part of it will remain wet with the milk fill. Okay, so it will increase the volumetric flow rate. That automatically means it will increase the velocity of milk going through the tubes. So it means it increases the Reynolds number, which in turn increases the Nusselt number and increases the convection coefficient and finally overall heat transfer coefficient of the system. So it also adds to the energy efficiency in addition to other benefits which I have told to you. Is that clear? So indirectly many things are happening simultaneously. So what will happen? Milk will be going into half of the tubes in first pass, come at the bottom and get collected at this side. So here at the bottom side you can see we are having a partition shown in the vapor space. So in this space where both condensed milk and vapor will be coming from top to bottom, as it is a falling film evaporator, milk is falling as well as vapor, as they are not having any space to go out from the top, they also have to come to the bottom to get out of the system because vapor separator is located at the bottom. So vapors will be coming at bottom as well as milk will be coming at bottom. Both are in parallel flow, both are coming simultaneously, and we are having this partition shown to you here by a dotted line, dotted vertical line at the bottom. So we are having a subdivision in this part so that one first pass can be connected to one of the centrifugal pump, which will be circulating this first pass milk to the second side of same calendria. Okay, so we are having evaporator 1 or calendria 1, which is letting milk circulate twice. So here you are seeing that this stream is coming back again into the same calendria onto the another side, and then the process will be repeating, and now finally we will be collecting this condensate or condensed milk stream from both vapor separator as well as this part going to the centrifugal pump, and it would be pumped to the next calendria, calendria 2 or evaporator 2. Okay, so this was regarding the milk part of it. Regarding flow pattern, I have already indicated you in the previous practical that we are having a milk distributor plate placed at the top of tube sheet. So those tube sheet, what they would be doing is they would be ensuring that all the milk streams coming into the tubes do not enter tube directly. They fall in between two or three tubes so that the milk spreads and then falls into the tube, so that the formation of milk is milk film is ensured in the curved surface area of the tubes. Otherwise what can happen is milk can bypass without touching curved surface area of tube. It can fall through gravity, by gravity, directly in the downward side. So to avoid that, milk distributor plate is placed at the top. So it will be distributing milk so that uniform film forms before it enters the tube. So same milk distributor plate will be also partitioned because we are having two passes. So milk distribution plate will also have a partition. For first part it would be separate, for second part it would be separate. So we would be having a circular cross section divided into two semi-circular sides. Is that clear? So this was regarding the product side. Now coming on to the steam side or heat transfer media side. Here you can see in the vapor separator 1, the vapors are supplied both to the TVR as well as to the Calandria 2 as to be utilized as a heating media. So through TVR, here we are having a steam inlet and vapors are coming at this side. So vapors along with steam will get mixed together, will form an intermediate pressure steam, because this vapor is only water vapors only and steam is also water vapor. So both will mix together, they will form an intermediate pressure steam which will go to the Calandria 1 heating media side to be utilized as a heating medium for evaporation in evaporator 1. And without TVR, these vapors are going to the heating media side of Calandria 2 to be utilized as heating medium in Calandria 2. So for Calandria 2, we are not raising either temperature or pressure for steam, because in Calandria 2 we are having much more less pressure existing on the product side. So boiling point of milk there is less. So same temperature steam can be utilized as a heating media for evaporation of milk. So without increasing temperature, we can utilize the vapor from same milk to evaporate the same milk because of difference in pressure. Is that clear? In Calandria 2, this is single pass, one pass only. So milk comes from the top via distributor plate. It goes into the tubes, it falls to the bottom. Vapors goes to vapor separator, milk gets collected from vapor separator as well as this Calandria bottom. Both are going to this pump, and here, from here you can see this is going directly to this balance tank which was for spray dryer. So balance tank for spray dryer, this is the condensed milk outlet for the evaporator. So product side ends here in the evaporation system. Now seeing that what are the heating media for all these four preheaters. So we are having four preheaters, one is main heater, three are preheaters. For preheater 1, this is connected directly in parallel to the condenser. So whatever is the hot media in the condenser is the heating media in the preheater 1. Similarly, the heating media for Calandria 2 is the heating media for preheater 2, because both are connected in parallel, you can see here. For preheater 3, this is connected in parallel to Calandria 1. So heating media for Calandria 1 is the heating media for preheater 3. And for final heater, we are having steam. So only two places we are having steam inlet, nowhere else in the evaporation system there is a steam. Is that clear?
Sir, at TVR.
At TVR and at this final heater. Only two places. Okay. Now after this this vapor separator 2, you can see this pipeline going to the condenser. This condenser, as I have already told you, this is a shell and tube type of heat exchanger, on which shell side we are having vapors. Here you can see this pipeline is connected in between, neither on top nor on bottom. So it is connected onto the shell side of the shell and tube heat exchanger. In the tube side, we are having cooling water from the cooling tower. Okay, indirect type of heat exchanger is there. So here you can see cooling water in and cooling water out. So cooling water enters in from here at the bottom, goes to top against gravity by pumping force provided at the inlet, and it will make a U-turn at the top, go to the remaining half of the tubes, return it, and then it will come out from here, cooling water outlet. So this cooling water outlet stream will go back to the cooling tower, so that water can be recycled after cooling it again. So water would be reused. So is that clear? So So on the shell side, we are having vapors which were extracted from the evaporator, both calendria 1 and 2. So whatever vapors are still there, they will go to this condenser. Why I am saying still there? Because most of the vapor have already been condensed onto the heating media side of calendria 1 and 2. Because in the calendria 1, when vapors were recirculated, some of the vapors get condensed here only. So some of the vapors are only remaining. Rest of the vapors condensed in the calendria 2. So whatever left vapors are there, they are from vapor separator 2 only, and they are going to the condenser. So we are having a less amount of water vapors to be condensed. And why do we need condensation of vapor here is to produce vacuum. So in evaporation system, as I have already told you, that we are having two type of systems for vacuum. One is vacuum production system, another is vacuum maintenance system. So condenser is producing vacuum, vacuum pump is maintaining vacuum, it does not produce vacuum. So condenser produces vacuum by condensation of water vapors, because water vapors are taking a lot of volume or space in the whole evaporation system, and those vapors when condensed leave the let that space. So the space which are left from the water vapor condensation is under partial vacuum. So that is how vacuum gets produced in the evaporation system. So condenser produces vacuum. So in the condenser shell side, we will be having condensation process occurring. In the condenser tube side, we would be having cooling media, which is cooling water from the cooling tower. Is that fine? So some of the vapors would be utilized for heating the milk in preheater 1, and rest of the remaining vapors are condensed in the this part, condenser. Now here you can also see these dotted lines. So these dotted lines, you can see these dotted lines are rising from various positions in the back side of the system. So in the back side of the system, this line is coming from this evaporator 1, this line is coming from evaporator 2, and these two lines are deaeration line. Because in the starting, when we were about to start evaporator, everywhere inside and outside of the evaporator pressure was atmospheric. We were required to first produce vacuum before letting the milk in to the system, so that the boiling point gets reduced. So these deaeration lines are directly connected towards this condenser line going to the condenser from vapor separator 2. And final deaeration line, here you can see from the top of condenser, is going to this pump. This is a vacuum pump. So initially this will remove all of the air present inside the system, so that initial vacuum can be produced. I am saying produced, not maintained. Initial vacuum can be produced by the vacuum pump, but as soon as evaporation commences, then the vaporization process will break vacuum, and then production of vacuum will be duty of a condenser. Initially condenser cannot produce vacuum because air is non-condensable. Air will be removed by vacuum pump. But as soon as vaporization commences, the amount of air required to be removed is very less. So now vacuum pump will be just maintaining the vacuum, not producing it. Is that clear? So this line here, from here, this is deaeration line going to the vacuum pump. This is a liquid ring type of vacuum pump. This is the liquid ring type of vacuum pump, which captures air or all other non-condensable gases in small pockets containing water, mixes it with water, and ejects that water out of the system. Because air can not directly be pumped out by a centrifugal pump. This is a kind of centrifugal pump only. So it cannot remove air from the system as such. So it needs to have water also with it, so that the air can be captured along with water. Is that clear regarding the vacuum pump part of it? So as we are having this condenser, surface condenser type, and vacuum is maintained by vacuum pump produced by this condenser, we are required to also provide a pump for removal of condensate, because we are not utilizing barometric leg here. Unlike previous experiment, here we do not have a barometric leg. So here you can see on this side, shell side, what we are having is, we are having this vacuum pump only connected here as well as here. So this side as well as this side, both sides are connected to the vacuum pump, so that all the condensate, which is water only, required for operation of vacuum pump, is provided by the condenser along with these non-condensable gases. They would be captured and simultaneously expelled. Is this part clear? So there are many differences if we compare it with the three-phase evaporator with TBR. So major differences are that we are having a surface condenser indirect type. There we were having direct type of condenser. There we were also having barometric leg. Here we do not have barometric leg. There we do not have these tubes for control of WPNI. Here in this side we are having WPNI control by using these tubes. Okay. So these are some of the differences, along with this difference of multipass in the first effect. So first effect of this evaporator is multipass. So more than one passes are there. So effectively it can be more than two effect. It can be considered as more than two effect. But we will be saying only double effect, because we are having physically two units. So here, that is why we are here, it is written double effect falling film evaporator. So evaporation side of it is clear to you here. Now coming on to the dryer part of it. So dryer will be starting from this feed tank. So we are having this feed tank, which was outlet for the evaporation system. So condensed milk from the evaporator will reach to this balance tank or feed tank of the dryer. And here this pump will be supplying this feed via a homogenizer to the dryer's atomizer. Okay, so you need to make this point clear, that what are the equipments before atomizer, in between feed pump and atomizer, feed tank and atomizer. So we are having this feed pump, then homogenizer, and also a heat exchanger here. So why this heat exchanger is there? Because from the evaporator, feed comes out at approximately 55 degrees Celsius maximum. Okay, not more than 55. If we give this 55 degrees Celsius feed to the dryer, most of the energy of air will be utilized to heat this milk, then to dry it. So we are providing this concentric tube heat exchanger. So this is a pipe in pipe type of heat exchanger, double pipe type of heat exchanger. Central pipeline, inner pipeline is carrying condensed milk, high TS milk, and outside pipeline will be carrying the heating media. Heating media will be hot water. We do not use steam. Steam will produce burning. It will induce burning, scorching. So we need to control delta T. Temperature difference needs to be controlled, because the milk is highly viscous here, and when it is highly viscous, it will be having much more heat induced changes. So hot water is used. So here you are seeing two sections, this section as well as this section, both are heat exchangers, and they are double pipe heat exchanger used to heat the milk as high as possible before entering it into the spray dryer. So it will be increasing overall efficiency, thermal efficiency of the drying system, along with improving the flow characteristics, because high TS feed going to the atomizer will be hard to atomize if its viscosity is high. So increasing temperature decreases viscosity and hence improves atomization. So this increase in temperature by use of these heat exchanger will serve two purposes. One of the purposes is to provide additional energy to the incoming milk into the drying system, so that maximum energy of hot air is getting utilized for drying of milk rather than heating of it, then decreasing the viscosity of feed. So this feed which is going inside the atomizer, its viscosity will be reduced. Here you are seeing a bypass line going back to the same tank from where it came. This is to make this sure that always there is feed available to the atomizer. Because on the atomizer side, what happens, if we are controlling flow rate of either homogenizer or feed pump, we can have a chance that feed is not sufficient going to the atomizer and we can have larger droplets produced inside. So if feed pressure drops, the atomization efficiency also drops. Droplet size increases, it is hard to dry. So to reduce the size of droplets, this is a pressure nozzle atomizer here. So to reduce the size of droplets produced, we need to have a high pressure behind atomizer. So to have high pressure, homogenizer produces and ensures high pressure. Feed pumps ensure proper feed supply to the homogenizer, so that homogenizer is having feed available at any flow rate and pressure. Okay. So if high pressure is there, atomizer orifice is very small, so there will be a lot of pressure built up, which can lead to a high degree of wear and tear to the orifice of the atomizer. So we provide a bypass line so that excess feed which is there can come back to the feed tank by a throttling valve. Here you can see there is a valve. So this valve will be throttled, it will not be fully opened. Otherwise, milk will be going to the least resistance path. It will not go into the dryer. So that milk get its way into the dryer, this valve will be throttled. And this bypass line will be ensuring that no system is over pressurized. Pressure can be relieved from this line. Is this part clear? In this side. So after this, we can now enter the drying chamber. In the drying chamber, we need a direct contact, because this is a spray dryer. So we need a direct contact with the heating medium for the milk droplets. So milk droplets are produced by the atomizer, nozzle atomizer. And here we are having air heating system, this side. So air sucked from the atmospheric conditions in the processing hall, not from outside. So it is from inside of the building, air will be sucked in by this side here. And this is the air inlet provided with the air filters. So air filters of proper mesh size will be covering this opening, going to the center of a blower. Blower will be sucking the air in through the air filter so that any dust, dirt, debris, extraneous matter, any insect pest, if any, is there, can be avoided to enter the product side. Then it enters this side, which is heating system. So here you can see this is a heat exchanger. Steam inlet is shown, condensate outlet is shown. So this is an indirect type of heat exchanger, this tubular heat exchanger, shell and tube type of. In the shell side we will be having air, tube side we will be having steam. Steam on the tube side will condense, air on the shell side will pass on to these tubes and then finally on to another heater to precisely control the temperature of air before it enters the drying chamber. Because in the drying chamber, according to the process to be followed, we need various temperatures. The temperature of air required inside the drying chamber vary from 180 to 250 degrees Celsius. It depends on what is required to be produced, whether it is skim milk powder, whole milk powder or dairy whitener or any other variant. Okay, for skim milk powder we can use higher temperature, for dairy whiteners and whole milk powders we need to keep lower temperatures because they would be having higher TS as well as higher heat induced damages associated with it. So we are required to maintain lower drying temperatures, so air temperature will be reduced. So this final heater here, it will be precisely controlling the temperature of air before it enters into the drying chamber from this side. So on the top here you can see on the periphery of the atomizer. So this is again a double pipe kind of system, in which on the central side we are having nozzle atomizer, on the peripheral side of the nozzle we are having a cone which will be circulating air so that we can ensure tangential entry of air into the drying system, so that when air enters into the drying chamber it does not enter from top to bottom direction, it enters in the cyclonic fashion. When it enters tangentially, it will be having initial swirling motion which will keep on continuing, and the milk droplets, whether dried or wet, will be carried along with the air stream suspended in it, and we can increase a bit drying time inside the drying chamber so that the milk droplet does not fall by gravity directly from top to bottom. So they will be swirling around and then slowly falling down, so that we can have increase in time which we can have in the drying chamber. Okay, so air along with the suspended particles will be coming down, and what happens as the particles of milk, means droplets of milk which are having a higher moisture initially, as soon as that contacts hot air, drying air, say at 180 degrees Celsius, there is a lot of temperature difference and a great amount of heat transfer occurs. So the moisture available on the surface of droplets instantly start evaporating, so that we can have a formation of slightly dried layer of product onto the periphery. But if this rate of drying is fast, then we can have case hardening. So to control that, what we need is, we need agitation, we need control of temperature of air, and also we need to control the movement of particles. If they are suspended in air for a longer time, then they can also become burnt or charred. So what happens? Slowly and slowly, the moisture from the peripheral side evaporates out, and simultaneously moisture migrates from the central part to the outside of those milk droplets. When that moisture migrates to the outside, it also starts evaporating. So it does not leave the surface dry. So in the drying chamber, until it comes to the bottom, the surface of particle is not completely dry. It is somewhat wet. It would be at least sticky. If not wet to touch, it would be sticky. But it will not dry. So for complete drying, we need second and third stage of drying. So this is a three stage dryer. In the bottom side of it, we are having a static bed, static fluidized bed. So static fluidized bed is there at the bottom, in which we are having hot air inlet from the bottom. So here you can see hot air coming at the top and at the bottom. But this bottom hot air is for this part, which is static fluidized bed. So more drying occurs here. Those sticky, wet to touch or sticky to touch particles are suspended in air, but this air here now is not at 180 degrees Celsius, but it is controlled by this another air heater, which is connected to another blower, which is in turn connected to another air filter, which would be sucking air from the same processing hall via that air filter, and it will maintain this temperature to roughly around 90 degrees Celsius. So 80 to 90 degrees Celsius temperature would be there at this side, SFB. So static fluidized bed, we will be having 90 degree air, because now there is less moisture to evaporate. If we are using higher temperature air, the moisture is not that much and particle can case harden. They can become charred. So to avoid that, we reduce the temperature of air here. Then after that, the dried particles which are partially dried, transfer to the next stage, which is vibro fluidized bed dryer, VFBD. So which is again a fluidized bed dryer with vibrations. So vibration will ensure higher agitation of particles, which is required because now particles are much more drier and much more which tend to settle down much more obviously. Because they are much more drier, they will tend to settle down. So to avoid that and to further keep drying going on, we require to agitate this vessel itself. So this whole system is mounted on springs with a vibrator motor. So vibrator motor, just like in our cell phones, we are having vibration mode. So that motor will be vibrating whole of this system. This system is mounted on a spring so that it does not make noise and it does not make contact and detaches its contact from other metallic surfaces. So they will be just like a silencer, and also ensure reduction in mechanical damage which are possible. So after this vibro fluidized bed dryer, we are having one more section in this vibro fluidized bed dryer for cooling, because powder particles are required to be packed in a slightly colder temperature than they were produced. So what are the temperatures? Initially it is going say about 70-80 degrees Celsius after this heater, say 70-80 degrees Celsius into the drying chamber. Then after it exits drying chamber, enter SFBD, static fluidized bed dryer, it may be around 80 degree or 75-80 degrees or so. Air will be at a higher temperature because we need delta T for heat transfer to occur. So air will be always at a higher temperature. Milk powder or other particles will be at a lower temperature. So at outlet, the powder particles will be at 75 or 80 degrees or so, depending on type of powder. So skim milk, less temperature will be there because more moisture was there, more of evaporating cooling has happened. For dairy whitener, for whole milk powder, higher temperature would be there. Exit temperature can be 90 degrees Celsius. But in that case, then air will be required to be at 100 or 110 degrees Celsius. So it depends on product, it depends on TS. So air which is coming, powder which is coming at SFBD is at 75-80 degrees Celsius. After SFBD, it goes into the vibro fluidized bed dryer at that temperature, say about 90 degrees Celsius. In that, it is maintained at that temperature, no further increase is done, because then we will be having Maillard browning reactions, because we are having residual moisture. At this part, static fluidized bed dryer, we may have 10-12% moisture. At vibro fluidized exit, we will be having about 5-4% moisture in the dried product. So this residual drying will be occurring in these further steps or further processes. Okay, so drying chamber, which is the largest chamber, largest volume, is taking least amount of time, say about 1-2 seconds it takes milk from coming here to here. In this static fluidized bed dryer, it may take 1-2 minutes. In vibro, it can take 5-10 minutes. So small chamber, larger time. Large chamber, very small time, but very fast evaporation rate. Here, very slow evaporation rate and less amount of moisture required to be removed. So when we are having high temperature, long time, Maillard browning reaction will be much more prone. So we need to control temperature. And if we do not reduce the temperature after here, say 90 degree was there, if we do not reduce the temperature, then we can have agglomeration of particles together to form a close tight structure known as caking, C-A-K-I-N-G, caking. So what it will do is, it will form a solid hard layer in the packaging material, so that the product is not so much reconstitutable, so it would not be that much useful along with Maillard browning. So we need to reduce the temperature. For that we need cold air. So in the second part of vibro fluidized bed dryer, here you can see there is one more air circuit. So at the bottom side of vibro fluidized bed dryer, we are having two chamber. On the top means product side, we are having single chamber. Division is on the air side, not on the product side. So product side is one continuous system, air side we are having two separate plenum chamber. It is known as plenum chamber, technical term is plenum chamber for this air chamber beneath this vibro or static fluidized bed dryer. So plenum chamber here, here and here, three plenum chamber are there. So here 90 degree air, here we would be having less temperature air. So the temperature of air which is supplied in this vibro final part is at 10-12 degrees Celsius, so that the powder which comes out of the system is at 20-25 degrees Celsius. Okay, so after this, here you can see that after vibro, we are having this out indicated air. So here a worker can stand with a bag to be filled in with powder. So this was regarding the powder side of it. Now coming on to the recirculation side of this system. So here you can see this line going to this cyclone separator, another line going back to the drying chamber from the atomizer. These are also there. So what are these lines? Why are they present here? So let me first explain this side. On the top of vibro fluidized bed dryer, one line is going to the cyclone separator. This side, this part is cyclone separator, in which fine particles, fine powder particles, which are getting blown away by the drying air or by the cooling air in the vibro fluidized bed dryer, are carried away, go to the cyclone separator, and cyclone separator collects them. So here at the downward side, here you can see one more stream is there. So it is collecting those fine powder particles and supplying back to the atomizer. How does that work? Cyclone separator is that it has a tangential entry of air. So air laden with dust. Why I am saying dust? Because the particles are very fine. So milk powder particles which are very fine can be referred to here in this case as dust. So this is milk dust. So air laden with this milk dust will be coming tangentially into the cyclone separator, so that it has the inertial, so in an initial swirling motion, due to which high density particles, which are dust particles, get thrown away on the peripheral side, and less density particles, which are air particles, get aggregated at the center. So by centrifugal force, dried particles are smeared onto the walls. By gravity, they fall down. Air get collected at the center, gets out at the central duct on the top, goes to this exhaust fan. So we are having an exhaust fan which removes air from whole of this drying system. Because up till here you have seen that there are many air entry points into the system. So we need to have some exit points as well, otherwise it will explode. So this is the only exit for air. So this has to be big enough so that it can support all other air inlet points, because you already know that drying chamber works under partial vacuum. So what it means? It means all of the air entering into the system has to be less than air exiting from the system. Otherwise, we cannot have negative pressures inside. So amount of air entering into the system has to be less than amount of air exiting the system, so as to create a negative pressure inside the system. Why negative pressures are required is to keep boiling points low, because evaporation is occurring inside, to keep it safe, because milk powder, which is organic in nature, when dried and finally fine dispersed state, is very well suited for burning. So it can explode like a bomb. So if we are having positive pressures inside, and if we have some spark, then it can explode like anything. So to ensure its safety, it has to run under vacuum. The level of vacuum is very, very minimal. It is not like the evaporator system. In the evaporator, we have very high vacuum. So what are the level of vacuums in the evaporator? It is up to 700 mm of Hg. 100% vacuum to hoga nahi, 760 nahi jayega. Up to 700 mm of Hg are the vacuum which can be achieved in the evaporator. So ye hoga kahan? Ye hoga condenser pe. Aage jate jate calendria 1 2 3 they would be on higher pressure, lesser vacuum. But in the drying chamber, it runs under very less vacuum. Level of vacuum is of the order of minus 10 to minus 12 millimeter of water column, not mercury, of water column. So in terms of water column, atmospheric pressure is 10.33 meter, not millimeter. In the drying chamber, we are maintaining millimeter minus, because it is vacuum. Is that clear? So minus 10 to minus 12 millimeter of water column vacuum is in the drying chamber. Higher vacuum will be there on the cyclone separator, because vacuum is produced by exhaust fan directly connected to the cyclone. Okay? So that is why in whole of the dairy industry, the exhaust air fan, exhaust fan motor is the largest size motor ever used in dairy industry for a spray drying plant. Iski motor. So it is the largest size motor which is ever used. So in any dairy plant, largest size motor is this. After that, second largest motor will be this. Feed inlet, air inlet. Because maximum air is to be supplied by this, and more than this, this will be removing. Okay. So fines which were collected by the cyclone separators need to be utilized. So they can be either collected as such, separately stored in some bags, or they can be put back into the system for size increase. Now we are required to increase their size. So they can be used for agglomeration purposes. How they can be used for agglomeration purposes? You can see here, this line which is coming at the bottom of cyclone, again there is air inlet, heated air is there. So this is a roots blower fan. The name of this is roots blower fan because it is blowing into the root of the cyclone. Cyclone ki jad hai na. So roots blower fan. So it blows into the root of cyclone, blows away these fine particles. Either they can go to the vibro or to the atomizer. We are having a selector valve here in between. So here you can see there is a circle indicated. Three pipelines are connected. One coming from root blower, two going to different places. So depending on the selection, whether it has been diverted towards vibro or towards atomizer. So what can be done and what are the advantages or disadvantages, or we can say applications, that in which case it should be sent to where? So it can be sent to atomizer in the case when we are required to provide some nucleation sites for the milk droplets to form. So what will happen? This air stream going into the system, it is not going into the atomizer, it is blowing into the stream milk spray, so that dried powder gets impinged into the wet droplets freshly produced. So they will be having a relatively drier core. Moisture does not need to migrate from center to the periphery, but after some distance to the periphery. So we would be having a relatively drier core and increase in particle size of these fine particles. This part is clear. Yahan kya hoga? What if it is placed to the vibro? In the vibro we are having input of sticky product. So what happens there is, on sticky product if we spray fine dried powder, then it smears onto the surface of that sticky product, and that can bind two or more particles together and form clumps of particles and form a hollow particle shape or size. So hollow particles will be created in vibro, so they will be having a better reconstitutability because they would be very easy to wet because they will be having pores. They are hollow particles, they are having pores, water will be going inside, wetting the particles from both outside as well as inside simultaneously, and dissolution will be very very quick. So to produce instant milk powders which are very instantaneously dissolvable, this is where it has to be diverted. Is that clear? Third side can be, it can be collected here only, not sent anywhere. So that particles, those, it is not that it is waste. They can be used for pharmaceutical industry to produce medicines. The medicines also have skim milk powders along with those chemical which are medicines mixed into this. Because you know that medicines are 10 mg, 20 mg, but tablets are in grams. So how are they? So rest of the part is milk part powder as well as other food ingredients. So there they use non-agglomerated fine particles because they are required to be compressed. So they do not need to be wetted. No agglomeration required.